So, Srinivasa, please. Yeah. Okay. Good afternoon to one and all present in this session. Today, we have with us Professor Siva Kumar Udgatha for the session Soft Sensing Systems. This is a continuation to the yesterday's class, most likely. But those who are not present in the yesterday's class, let me introduce you to the SAR profile. Dr. Siva Kumar Udgatha is a professor in the School of Computer and Information Sciences, University of Hyderabad, and Institute of Eminence. He served Center for Modeling, Simulation and Design, CMSD, as a director between the year 2012 to 2016. He was a United Nations Fellow and worked in the United Nations University, International Institute for Software Technology, MACAW, as a research fellow in the year 2001. His research focus is on intelligent algorithms for wireless communication, mobile computing, sensor network, and applications. He has worked as a principal investigator in many funded research projects, funding of rupees around 4.5 crores approximately, in collaboration with Stanford University, University of California, IIT Delhi, NIST, Berhampur, and few others. He has published research papers extensively in the many peer-reviewed international journals and conferences. He is the associate editor of KES Journal of Knowledge-Based Systems and AKCE Journal. He has edited 10 Springer conference proceedings and also co-authored a book on Internet of Things and Sensor Network for COVID-19. Thank you, sir. Thank you for accepting our invitation. You are very much kind enough to accept to deliver a lecture here. So may I now request Professor Udgatha, sir, to take over the session, please. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Nagender. And just for information, Dr. Nagender was the another author for that last book, Internet of Things and Sensor Network for COVID-19. So we both wrote that book, and it's available in the Springer site and as well as in Amazon and all that. Yeah. So before going further, let me share the screen and then we'll discuss.
It is visible, sir.
Visible, right?
Yes, sir. Yes.
So it's visible until the end, right? Or there is something else? Or only the PowerPoint slides are visible?
PowerPoint slides are visible, sir. You please go into the presentation mode, sir.
This is in the presentation mode now.
No, sir.
It's not changing.
Yeah, it's not changing. Sir. It's not in the presentation.
Not changing.
Yes, sir. Slides are moving, sir.
Slides are
changing.
Now
it is coming. Yeah. Now it's coming, sir.
Okay. Yeah, it took some time. Fine. So it's a more or less it's a continuation of the yesterday's talk. Yesterday I talked about intelligent sensors and some of its applications. So what is the intelligent sensor? Why we think of an intelligent sensor? What are the strength and weaknesses of the sensors? So when you have a sensor, what are the problems and all that? So today we'll talk about a soft sensor. So we talked about hardware sensors and all these things, right? Now can we think of a soft sensor? So a soft sensing system and few applications. So as Professor Nagender said, I am Siva Udgatha. I work for this School of Computer and Information Sciences. Yeah. So I picked up from the slide which I displayed in the last class also. So what are the basic problems with sensors, right? So the first three points I've already discussed. So sensor accuracy increases with the cost. So if you want a high accuracy sensor or you want a very high reliable sensor, the cost is very high. That is one. Now in the market, there are lots of cheap sensors, low cost sensors are available, but they are very, very less reliability and limited operating range. For example, you cannot measure a temperature of 500 degrees centigrade with a low cost sensor. So the operating range is limited. Reliability is limited and the cost is also less. But if you want more reliable, more operating range and all that, then you need to spend more on that sensors actually. Now, so these are the three points which I discussed. And the last point which I added for this particular talk is that if you look at this, difficult to measure some of these conditions, right? There are few cases and we'll discuss few cases then. there are few cases where the sensors, where the when the conditions are not very suitable for installing sensors and getting the data. So there are some, so difficult to measure because of the harsh conditions, because of the high cost. Some sensors are very, very highly costly. And there are few cases where the sampling time is very high. For example, a 2-day, 3-day, 4-day, 5-day, etc. I'll give you a small example here. I think in the last class also I said, I work on water quality monitoring system, a sensor-based water quality monitoring system, and we did a project on that also. Now, what happens there is that there are some sensors, for example, biological oxygen on demand, chemical oxygen on demand, BOD, COD, they call it as, for water quality monitoring. These are the sensors to monitor the quality of the water. So BOD is one sensor, COD is one sensor, but BOD, COD sensor measurement, it requires culture and all that. So it takes time actually. So you require 4 days or 5 days time to find out what is the BOD content or what is the COD content of the particular water. And this is also used in sewage water treatment plants and all that. So the first condition is that the sampling time may be very high. So that makes it unsuitable or not suitable for real-time monitoring or online monitoring. The cost may be very high so that you may not be able to afford it. There may be conditions which doesn't allow you to install the software there, etc. For example, a river is flowing, etc. Where do you put these sensors? Unless there is a bridge or something, you cannot install the sensor. So there are certain conditions where a sensor cannot be installed. The cost will be prohibitive. And some cases, the sampling time, that means the sensing time is so high that it makes it unsuitable for the real-time monitoring. So this is in addition to other problems which we discussed in the last class. They are there in the first 4 bulleted points here. This is the additional point which I want to discuss and what you can do with this. So in these circumstances where the measuring the sensor data or measuring the sensor observations becomes difficult or becomes costly because of these parameters like harsh condition, high cost, sampling time, etc., then can we think of replacing a hardware sensor with a soft sensor? So if you look at the definition of the soft sensor, again, I go back to Wikipedia and all that. So soft sensor, the term soft sensor is a combination of words, software, because models are developed in computer programs, and sensors, because these models providing similar information as hardware sensors. So this is one, there is a software, there is a sensor. So that makes the word soft sensor. And this is developed in such a way that it will provide similar information as hardware sensor. So if you have a hardware sensor, it will measure the data. If you have a software sensor, that means a model or a software embedded in the sensor board, that will also measure the, that will also give the same data. So it's a soft sensor in some restricted, constrained environment can act as a hardware sensor or can replace the hardware sensor. That's one definition. So the term soft sensor is a combination of the word software, because models are developed in computer programs, and sensors, because these models are providing similar information as hardware sensor. That's very important. The second definition of the second bulleted point is that software sensors are also known as virtual sensors. They are not real sensors. They are not hardware sensors. They are not real sensors. So sometimes we call soft sensors as virtual sensors also. So it is used to provide feasible and economical alternative. So because as I told you, the sensor cost may be very high and it may not be economical for us to go for the sensor, hardware sensors. Now in some cases, can we replace the hardware sensor with a virtual sensor, or a real sensor with a virtual sensor, or hardware sensor with a soft sensor? So soft sensor and virtual sensors, they're almost synonym in nature. So that's what, so it's a, it provides a feasible and economical alternative to costly and impractical physical measurements. So if it is very costly, and sometimes it's also not practical for measuring the physical environment. I continue with this. So soft sensor used to predict important quantities or variables that are difficult to measure using hardware or physical instruments. I repeat. So let's say I have 3 variables or 5 variables. Like I want to monitor X1, X2, X3, right? Now X1, X2, X3, X4 or something, right? Or X5, up to these 5 parameters I want to monitor. Now if I want to monitor X1, X2, X3, X4, X5, now let's say there is a variable X5, or there is an observation X5, which is very difficult to measure using hardware because of, or physical instrument, because of this stated reasons. The cost may be very high, the condition may be very harsh, the sampling time may be very high. So what do you do? So the soft sensor are used to predict important quantities. So the soft sensor is used to predict the value x5 using x1, x2, x3, x4, etc., where it is difficult to measure x5 because of some constraints or some measurements. Go to the second bulleted point. The soft sensor synthesizes the information from physical sensors. Now let's say this is a physical sensor, this is a physical sensor, this is a physical sensor, and this is a physical sensor. So x1, x2, x3, x4 are physical sensor or hardware sensors. So it synthesizes the information from the physical sensor and records the data to perform a number of tasks such as estimation of quantities that cannot be measured directly or variables that are difficult to measure using hardware sensors. So, I mean, forget this paragraph. Let me explain in a different way. So x1, x2, x3, x4 are four hardware sensors, but I want information x1, x2, x3, x4, x5. So what happens is that the hardware sensor will measure x1, x2, x3, x4 because they are very less costly, because the sampling time is very less. So immediately we can get this. And we'll use this parameter x1, x2, x3, x4, etc. to estimate what is the value of x5. Now using different models. Now, if you can predict or estimate the value of x5 correctly, then the x5, you don't need a hardware sensor or a physical sensor for x5. X5 can be replaced by that model or by that algorithm or by that software for estimating the value of x5. So that becomes, thus x5 becomes a soft sensor. So soft sensors have been applied to several industrial applications in the past and for process control and monitoring. There are many industrial applications in production, in manufacturing of chemical plants, etc. People have used the soft sensor because those are hazardous environment. The sensors are very costly and many a times it is difficult to measure it in a real-time environment. So the industrial people, particularly the chemical industrial people, they use soft sensors for soft sensor means the software equivalent of the hardware sensor. The industrial process, second bulleted point, the industrial process variables are categorized as the terms of their measurability into easy to measure and difficult to measure. So the variables which you want for our analysis, for our action and all these things. So the variables or the parameters that you want to measure, you can divide them into two types. One is called easy to measure and the other one is called difficult to measure. Now, what is easy to measure? As I told, the cost may be less, the time may be less, the environment may be good, or it is easy to measure, there is not much of an error and all that. So it's an easy to measure argument. So what is easy to measure? If you look at this, easy to measure variables are referred to as independent variables, predictors, secondary variables, model inputs, whatever it is. So what is easy to measure variable? Suppose in this case, go back to the previous slide, x1, x2, x3, x4, x5. X1, x2, x3, x4 are considered to be easy to measure variables. They are also independent variables because they are not dependent on anything. The sensor will directly measure it. X5 is a difficult to measure variable because, and X5 is also a dependent variable. Why I call it a dependent variable? Because this is dependent on the value of X1, X2, X3, X4, etc. So that you can estimate the value of X5. That's the idea. So what is difficult to measure variable? Difficult to measure variables are also referred to as dependent variable. Why do I call it a dependent variable? Because X5 is dependent on X1, X2, X3, X4. It cannot be independently measured. But X1, X2, X3, X4 can be independently measured by installing or deploying hardware sensors, right? Now, there are types of soft sensors. Soft sensors can be of two types. Model-driven soft sensors, we'll not be talking about that. Actually, we'll focus on data-driven software. But I'll just tell you what is a model-driven soft sensor and what is a data-driven soft sensor. The model-driven soft sensors are basically the physical equations, mathematical equations, the physical models. For example, if I know that PV equal to RT, Boyle's law, Charles law, etc., right? People who have done physics, etc., or chemistry, they might be knowing. There's a Boyle's law, there's a Charles law. PV equal to RT, that means pressure is directly proportional to temperature and volume is directly proportional, inversely proportional to pressure, etc. Now, if you can design a model, that means you can find out a mathematical equation for the dependent and independent variables because from your scientific experiments, etc., then that's called as a model-driven software. What is a data-driven software? I don't know anything about the nature of the, there is no law, there is no nature of the equation. I cannot fit an equation, etc. But I have data. I collected the historical data. I collected data for last 1 year, 2 years, 6 months, 2 months, etc. And then using that data, I will fit the model. So I don't know how this dependent variable behaves, but I have the data. Now, once I have the data, I can fit a model there and then predict what is the output. So model-driven soft sensor means we don't have data, but you have mathematical equations, mathematical understanding, physical understanding. And that mathematical equation, physical understanding can be written as a software, and that software will replace the hard sensor. That's a model-driven model. And it's really difficult, because if you would have known the science behind it, if you know the equations behind it, probably there is no point in developing sensors also. You can directly do that. But whereas data-driven soft sensors are basically, you have data about the past behavior, and depending on the past behavior, you try to predict a curve or predict an equation. Now that is called data-driven soft sensor. I think I have already told you what is model-driven soft sensor. This type of sensors mainly based on deriving equations that can describe the process by physical and chemical background. So physics people, chemistry people, they have defined equations. Now, if you can come out with the equation, that's a model, right? It's not a data model, it's a model, mathematical model. But if you have a data, you don't know the mathematical model, but you have the data, then the data will lead to a particular equation. So that's a data-driven model. So what is a data-driven soft sensors? Data-driven soft sensors are based on measured data retrieved from the plant. So if you have a manufacturing plant or if you have a chemical plant, et cetera, so the data, the measured data will be retrieved. So you collect all the data that is measured, store it. Then the data-driven soft sensor resembles process states. Why do you say resembles process states? Because when the process is on, different states of the process is on, you collect the data and store it. This is more realistic. Why I call it a more realistic? Because this is what is happening in practice, in the field. So in the field, you put up some sensors, collect the data, and that data comes, and this data, so the data-driven soft sensor resembles the process state more realistically and describe the input-output relationship. Why do I call it input-output relationship? Now, if there is an increase in a particular parameter, you will see there is an output. So there's an input-output relationship, and this input-output relationship is exhibited in the data set. There is no equation for that. The function is not well-defined. So the data-driven soft sensors are comparatively easier. Why it is easier? Because it's just a software, right? It's just a software so that you can put that software into the embedded mode, and then it starts working. To design and cheaper to implement. Why it is cheaper? You don't have to purchase any hardware for that actually, right? Separate hardware for that. So data-driven soft sensors are comparatively easier to design and cheaper to implement when compared to hardware sensor or model-driven sensors. That's how it is. So in this talk, in this presentation, we mainly focus on data-driven soft sensors. Yeah. There are many soft sensor applications are there. We'll also look at some of them. Applications, particularly in industrial plants, in application process monitoring and controlling purposes. What is online prediction? That's what I started saying. When I say online prediction, I say that whenever you have a sensor, the sensor sampling time means the time taken by the sensor to measure a particular quantity, right? Now, if you remember, or maybe you might have seen, suppose you want to measure your body temperature, you take a thermometer, put it under your armpit, and you have to wait for 1 minute, right? For the temperature to settle down. Now that 1 minute is known as the sampling time for measuring body temperature using mercury-based thermometer. That's the idea. So that's the 1 minute. And there are sensors, there are certain variables, there are certain parameters which take even days together. So online prediction will be difficult for those type of variables. And soft sensor applications can be done for online prediction of those parameters, those sensors, where the sampling time is very high. So once you do an online prediction, you can online prediction or real-time prediction, you can always do the monitoring of the process. Usually, if you look at this, I'm just underlining this part. Principal component analysis is a standard technique in machine learning, statistics, and all that. The principal component analysis is basically to find out those variables, or those equations, or those curves, which are very close to the data points, right? So if you have 100 data points, data points are distributed in a particular plane, then you fit a curve or fit a line, whatever it is, then what happens is that the line is fitted in such a way that the distance from the data points to this line is minimum. Right? That's how it is actually. So many successful examples are there. If you, in any FDP or any talk, the talk is only to excite you, introduce you to a particular subject and excite you, right? The talk cannot be completely 100% self-contained so that you can learn everything. Now, I'm only trying to introduce the concept of a soft sensor, the things what you have done, and then it is left to you if you are doing research or doing something, then you can see, think that in your domain, in your research, how this soft sensor can be useful in IoT or the sensor network environment. So there are successful examples of soft sensor applications in that are there in the oil and petrochemical industry. I tell you, if you look at oil and petrochemical industry, chemical plants, etc., why I'm telling these things? Because of two reasons. One, it is not easy to measure all the parameters in an oil and pharmaceutical industry because they are hazardous environment, number one. Number two, the sensors are very costly. So it makes the system very, very costly. And number three, it is always not easy for us to go there and deploy them and all these things. So, and they are also, and the sampling time is also very high, so that online prediction, online monitoring is not possible. So now in this era with IoT, we want to monitor the development, the control process online. Now, if you want to measure online, it has to be real time, right? It has to be fast. Now, if it is not fast, we will not be able to monitor. So soft sensor is a good alternate for a sensor which has a very high sampling rate. So what is this data-driven software sensor design? The design is, if you look at the flowchart kind of a thing, we have specifying the model application. First, you have to design an application. For which application we are going to design the soft sensor? We'll discuss some of them in the coming slides. Then process the data analysis part. So first, you know, I'm talking about the data-driven software sensor design, right? It's a data-driven. It's a data-driven model. So if it's a data-driven, then you have to analyze the data first. Analyze the data in the sense that you process the data, clean the data, fit a model to the data. So all these things comes under the data analysis part. Once that model is done, right, you identify the model, which model you want to use. There are many models, actually. Many machine learning models are used. And you identify the a particular model in the sense, implement these models, do simulation, do experimentation, etc., and find out which model works best for you. Once that is done, what is this? Then you have to validate it. And we'll also see that how we have validated it and all that. So you have to validate your model in a real scenario or in the plant or in the factory or in the deployment site. You validate it. Once the validation is done, that means what we did, first we found out an application where you have to do it. Second, we collect the data, the historical data, and then we start analyzing data using different models, etc. Then you identify a model which works best for that particular application. Validate the model. Validate the model means do the testing for some time. Once the model is identified, frozen, and validated, then you implement and start maintaining. Implement means what? You put that code into the sensor node. But remember, when you embed the code model into the sensor node, the data, it's a continuous process, right? So you have used, let's say, 1 year data, 2 months data, or 6 months data, etc. You have developed a soft sensor for that. Then you have embedded that there, but the wall doesn't stop there. It moves on, right? The sensor node still works. So you get another 1 year data, 2 year data, 3 year data, 4 year data. So sometimes what happens is model needs maintenance. Maintenance means because the data over a period, the data drifts. For example, because of climate change, last year data, before last year data, or 10 year data is no more valid now. So the model needs validation. Model needs change, maintenance over a period of time. So implement the model and maintain the model. So this is how overview of a soft sensor design, the architecture of a soft sensor design. Now this data-driven soft sensor design, I will continue with that. So what is that we try to do? The design is mainly based on the historical data. I've been telling that actually. Retired from the plant database or wherever the data is or the sensor is deployed. And mainly these sensors are deployed in the manufacturing plants and all that. So and they are mainly manufacturing plants are using soft sensors. So I've used this word plant. Plant means manufacturing plant, not tree. It's not a tree. So the design is mainly based on the historical data. What is historical data? The data which is already collected in the past. That's called historical data, retired from the plant databases. And the quality of the developed sensor is totally dependent on the quality of the data retrieved. That's very important. So the quality of the sensor, the quality of the developed sensor also depends on the quality of hardware sensors, because it is basically depends on that. So quality of other hard sensors and the way you, because if the other sensors, physical sensors are not good, then the quality of the data retrieved is not good. If the quality of the data retrieved is not good, the soft sensor you develop will also not be good. So there are different steps. You do a data collection and inspection in the sense that what I mean by inspection, sometimes the data that you collect from a sensor is not available, it's corrupted, there is a noise, it is missing data. So do the collect the data and then inspect the data for outliers, for missing data. And then the entire process is known as the inspection of the data or cleaning up the data. You clean the data so that it can be started. You can start using directly. Then the model selection. Now, as I told you, the model selection is the key, very, very critical step in soft sensor design. And the model is the backbone of the soft sensor. This is the work. Because if the model is there, that itself is the soft sensor actually. Now the model can be static or dynamic model. As I told you, if I take 2 years past data, develop my model, embed it and deploy it and forget it. That's a static model. But what is a dynamic model? I take 2 years of data, develop the soft sensor, deploy it, but then there is a provision for dynamically changing the model because the data from the current data also will participate in the model. So that's a dynamic environment because when the new data comes, your model also keeps changing. Whether now at what frequency you change it, whether you do it after 1 year or 6 months or after a day or after every data item, that's a design choice actually. So dynamic models most often resemble with the reality or more than the static model because dynamic model considers the immediate past data. Static model considers the data which you have used for your design in the model. Then as I told you, then once the model is ready, then the model has to be identified, the model has to be and all trained. The performance need to be evaluated using the test data. So what do? You take some data, which is the test data, and start testing the model for the accuracy that it gives. If it gives good accuracy, then you accept it or you change the model again. What is the concept of adaptive soft sensor? The adaptive soft sensor means since soft sensors are developed offline, usually they will be developed offline. We take the data and then develop it. So adaptive soft sensor is basically a typical case of dynamic soft sensor. Because the soft sensor is developed offline and then that model you deploy it in the or embed into the in the sensor node. And the historical data used to build the soft sensor usually do not contain all process conditions. I mean, this is very important actually. Okay. Now let me tell you. Let's say I'm measuring wind speed, humidity, temperature, etc. in the environment. But it might happen that you have not the data in the last 2 years or 1 year or 6 months, whatever, it may not consist of or it may not contain all the extreme conditions, right? What happens if there is a cyclone happens? Cyclone didn't happen in 1 year time or last 2 years, and they do not happen every now and then, right? So, and we don't know how the data will be behaving in a cyclone condition or extreme condition, etc. So that is one of the restrictions or limitation of a soft sensor that can, unless these physical sensors collected the data in harsh or in rare conditions or in not so frequent conditions, you will not be able to develop a soft sensor which will also behave same way or similar manner for a harsh or not so frequent conditions. That's very important. So what you are saying, so usually it do not contain all the process conditions. It will not contain cyclones, it will not contain earthquakes, it will not contain extreme cold situations. So all those situations, because they are not there, and because these conditions, the process conditions are not there, you don't have equivalent data for that also. So in your model, those extreme conditions are not properly documented. So that's a problem. So what people are doing is that they get actual data from the process and they simulate some of the extreme condition data, whatever possible data. And in fact, 2 days back, I was in another university actually, and that's a Mangalore University. And for some inspection and all that. So what they were doing, I saw the experimentation actually, what they were doing, it's a good model actually. They have developed they were trying to monitor the radiation. I mean, they're working on a nuclear plant and all that, right? So they are trying to see that, is there any radiation present? And what is the content of radiation when the nuclear plant is in operation, etc. Now they find that, what is the impact of that radiation in the environment? Now the environment is a different thing, right? Environment can be in the rainy season, there should be rain. In the summer season, there will be summer, and summer also 40 degrees centigrade, 45, 50. So there are different environments actually. So what they have done, they have designed a chamber, a kind of a room. In that room, they simulate all types of environmental conditions. So what is that? The rain. So they simulate rain. That means there are showers and the water will go there. And inside that, there are these radiation measuring sensors. So they do that actually. So what is that I'm trying to say? From the process, from the site, you get whatever data you want. And inside the lab, you create a simulated environment. For example, you create rain, you create temperature, you create humidity, and then these actual data plus this simulated data, they come together, and your sorption sensor will be trying to adapt to that particular environment. So sometimes this adaptation is required, because you remember in the last class I talked about a drift. What is a drift? The sensor value, the physical sensor values, drifts, changes, or shifts its value, or shifts its midpoint or initial point over a period of time. Now that also happens with the soft sensors, because soft sensors will also be able to incorporate the drift. If it can incorporate the drift, then it is as good as a physical sensor. So adaptive soft sensor is basically, it is adaptive to the environment, it is adaptive to the drift, and the soft sensor is more equivalent or more resembles or with the hard sensor or physical sensor. So there are many techniques. Some of the techniques you will see, there are artificial neural techniques where you can use multi-layer perceptrons. There are various machine learning algorithms, including deep learning, like machine learning algorithms like SVM, KNN. There are so many, right? Random forest. There are so many machine learning algorithms. There are artificial neural network, deep learning, multivariate statistical techniques, right? PCA and all these things. So all these techniques are used to build adaptive soft sensor techniques. Now I'll go for this one application, right? So I described you what is a soft sensor, how soft sensor works, why do you need soft sensor, why physical sensors are difficult, what is the basic fundamental. In fact, I tried to avoid a lot of mathematical details, because as such we are in online mode, and then the mathematical details makes the presentation quite clumsy. So but I presented the abstract, the concept of a soft sensor. There is definitely a mathematical model behind it, but I presented the abstract view of a soft sensor. What is a soft sensor, why it is required, etc. Now let me talk about our experience about a building about a soft sensor, how we did it and all that. So as I mentioned that we worked on a project to monitor the water quality. Water quality monitoring requires a lot of parameters like pH, dissolved oxygen, turbidity, conductivity, temperature, BOD, biological oxygen demand, COD, and the iron content in the water. And you believe me, there are around 700 parameters that define the quality of the water, more than 700. But of course, we don't use 700 parameters. Mostly people use 5, 6, 7, 8 parameters. Your AquaGuard thing, they give you they come with it, and that measures only turbidity. That doesn't matter anything else. So, but to have a good quality of water, and then you know the water used for different purposes also. Some water will be used for agriculture purpose, some water will be used for drinking purpose, some water will be used for medicinal purpose, pharmaceutical industry, etc., where the water has to be very, very pure. So measuring the water quality, anything, quality is a perception, right? So measuring the water quality is an important parameter. And those 700, 600 parameters, or there are so many parameters in the water quality, and becomes very, very difficult for us to measure all the qualities of the water, all the quality parameters of the water, because of the stated reasons. The cost, there are sometimes the sensors are not available as of now. Whenever the sensor is available, it is very, very costly. Even if it is very high costly, it is not that reliable. And in many cases, some of the parameters, for example, BOD, COD measurement takes around 5 days. 5 days is the sampling rate. You have to bring it to the lab, measure it and all that. And which makes it unsuitable for the real-time monitoring. So in our case, so what you are doing, the Internet of Things-based water quality monitoring system mostly use cost-effective sensors with a faster response time. That's the importance actually. Unless you have that, you will not be able to use it in an IoT platform. Now, few water quality parameters, as I mentioned, such as chemical oxygen demand, COD, biological oxygen demand. These are basically chemical oxygen demand and biological oxygen demand. For example, biological oxygen demand means the biological elements, for example, mosses, fishes, etc. Unless the BOD is good, they will not be able to survive in that water. So that is very important if you have aquaculture, right? For prawn or for fish, etc. The BOD is a constant measurement. There is a slight change in the BOD, all your fishes die. All your prawns die. Similarly, chemical oxygen demand is that how much chemical component is there and how much oxygen is there so that it can neutralize, oxidize the chemical component actually, so that the water is still safe. So chemical oxygen and demand, biological oxygen demand, chlorine content, the amount of chlorine that is available in the water, if it is very high, it will create a lot of problem in your internal. So, and it is low, it will not be able to fight the bacteria and all that. So chlorine content, these sense total phosphorus, how much phosphorus is there? These parameters are hard to be measured online. I repeat, these parameters are very hard to measure online because of sensors are not available. Even if the sensor is available, it is not, it's quite costly. It is not, it's not friendly, real-time friendly. It takes more time and it's not very reliable also many a times. So soft sensing is a technique which can be used as an alternate. I repeat, it can be used as an alternate to the hardware sensor or the physical sensor in many cases. And in some cases, this is the only alternate you have because you don't have a physical sensor there. Now, first, let me talk about COD soft sensor development, our experience about the COD soft sensor. What is COD? Chemical oxygen demand. I will be discussing these two actually, chemical oxygen demand and biological oxygen demand. Similar work actually. So chemical oxygen demand and biological oxygen demand. So COD, the problem is, I mean, the COD soft sensor development, our experience then. So soft sensing technique helps development of a low cost, reliable, IoT-based water quality monitoring system. That's my objective. The COD sensor, as I told you, as of now, it ranges from 1500 to USD to 3000 USD minus GST and all that, but it approximately 2 lakh rupees. Even with 2 lakh rupees, it's not very reliable. It is not very fast online. It is not able to monitor online and all that. So COD soft sensor proposed as a data-driven ML. So in this case, we propose it as a data-driven ML. I told you about data-based or data-oriented soft sensor. So this is a data-driven ML means machine learning method to estimate the value of the COD in an online IoT system. So what you're doing, if you develop a water quality monitoring IoT system, the COD sensor is not available. Still, what you are doing will develop a soft sensor for COD, and that will be integrated with the IoT system so that in the online IoT system, you get COD parameter also. And COD is an important parameter. This system, this proposed system, eliminates the COD sensor. You don't need a COD sensor by replacing the hard or physical COD sensor with a COD soft sensor. So and of course it will reduce the overall cost of the system. So it will reduce the overall cost of the system. So what is that we are doing? It eliminates the COD physical sensor with a COD soft sensor, which results in overall cost reduction of the system. And also it increases the response time because we do it in an online thing. The edge device, what is an edge device? By this time, you had so many sessions on IoT, you might be knowing edge device means that sensor node, the end node there at the edge. It is where it is deployed, etc. This requires, so if you put models, software there, right? Then what happens, the machine learning system requires more energy actually, because machine learning requires more computation, it requires more energy. So the only problem with this is that if you try to develop the model at the edge device, then the machine learning, it requires more energy. So what you do, I mean, what we did in this case is that we tried to use as cloud and edge together. So the model will be developed in the cloud. Once the model is developed, it will be embedded into the end device. So that's how this strategy of distributing the work, right? Some will be the data collection, etc., will be in the end node or the edge node, and the model building, model training, etc., happens in the cloud. And then once the model is built, it can be deployed in the sensor node itself. Okay. Now, this is the soft sensing architecture. In fact, we use this model actually. So what do you do? I mean, if you look at this, these are some water sources, whatever water sources we have. So these are some water sources. Now we get water. Suppose first what you did, we get the water sample and did it, the measure the values in the laboratory itself, in a chemical laboratory or in an environmental science laboratory. These are laboratory measurements. So we collected the data, we collected the water sample, did the laboratory experiment, that is the actual data actually. You go to the chemistry lab or environmental science lab and collect it. That we also did. Then what happens, there are physical sensors. Some physical sensors are there like pH, temperature, and then what do you call, turbidity. So some sensors are, so whatever sensors are there, we collect the data using the physical sensors. The sensors which are not there, or which you want to develop for a soft sensor, we took the data and tested it in the laboratory. Now at the edge layer, so this is the sensor layer. Sensor layer means to collect the data. So how we collected the data? Using the physical sensor and also using the laboratory measurement. In the edge layer, look at this. This is the edge node, right? So this edge node is the node where the sensors are there. So this collects the data, that is the data acquisition. Then live prediction and control. What is live prediction and control? You collect the data on the live, on real, online, you collect the, you predict it, and then control the parameters. What is controlling the parameter? You have to take some actions, right? You have to, either you have to switch on the aerator, or you have to make add some chemical to that so that the COD becomes normal, etc. So this is a, then it will become the COD prediction. Once the COD, now look at this. This data acquisition here, this data acquisition module will send the data to the cloud or the server. In the cloud layer, the training happens. Right, so the training happens in the cloud layer, and once the cloud layer training happens, the model file is here. I get the model file, the model parameters, the trained parameters. Those trained parameters will be used for live prediction and control. This is what is the total total architecture actually. So what we did, we deployed edge nodes and in the water, near the water source. The physical sensors will collect the data directly. The sense for which we don't have sensors, we took that sample to the laboratory. We collected the laboratory. We measured it using the laboratory environment. Then this, after the data acquisition is complete, we send that data to the cloud for training. The training happens in the cloud or at the server. Once the training is done, everything is done, that matrix, the trained matrix, the trained weights will be sent back to the edge node. In the edge node, it will collect the data, use that particular training weights, etc., and predict it. Now this COD will be predicted. Okay. Now look at this. This is the environment are of two types here. One is that we have this side. If you look at the right side, So the right side is that this is a. If you look at this, this is a part of the India map, and the this is the trace actually. This is the river Ganga trace. Now during if you remember 2 years back, or I think 1.5 year back, so there was a Kumbh, right? Kumbh. So Kumbh means many people went to Allahabad and other places to take holy dip and all that. And at that time, the government of India and also the Uttar Pradesh state government, they had some a website where they continuously display the water quality of the river Ganga. And what we did is that we collected those data at different points of the time, day, every hourly duration, half an hour duration, 15 minute duration. So we collected a lot of data from the website. Now look at this. This is secondary data. I didn't do that experiment in this case. So in the experimental setup one, we went to the portal of the Government of India Water Commission, and then from there they continuously displaying the data about the water quality, because crores of people, lakhs of people went there to take holy dip. So the quality monitoring was very important. So they were continuously monitoring the quality, and what they have done, they have put sensors on the rivers at various places, actually at different places, and at those different points they started measuring the data and put up on the portal so that people can look at that, what is the quality going on. Even the government, the administrator also look at the quality, and they try to clean it, etc., so that the water remains safe. So what are the water quality monitoring parameters they have done? They have collected COD, DO, PD, pH, temperature, total solid, total carbon, ammonia, nitrate, turbidity, water level, means yesterday we talked about water level, etc., right? So they continuously collected this data and put up on the portal. What we did, we collected the records. How many records we have collected? We have collected around 16,100 records, if you look at this. Now, 16,100 records we collected over a period of time. There were 35 in the nearer to Allahabad, etc., there were 35 installed centers. So they are basically the edge nodes, the IoT nodes. From there, they collect the data. We didn't participate in that. The Government of India did that. We only collected the data. So installed in states of Uttarakhand, Uttar Pradesh, Bihar, West Bengal, that's in the coast, in the river line actually. So there are 35 installed nodes. We collected around 16,100 samples of the data, and the parameters are COD, DO, pH, TM, temperature, and all these things, right? So this is one. This is setup one, experimental setup one. Now this is setup two. So what we did, so setup two, what we did, so this is one part of the story. We used it for validation. In the other part of the story, if you look at it, this is like a small boat actually, this part actually, a small boat. I think Dr. Nagender, while introducing me, talked about that we did some project with IIT Delhi and all that. So this is part of that particular project. So at NIST Berhampur, we developed it's a kind of a small boat actually, mechanized boat actually. Not a boat actually, you know, in water body, people, kids play with boats and all that. So similarly, this one is the solar panel. And here, if you look at this here, they are the sensor nodes, quality parameters, sensors and all these things. And this is moving in the water body and collecting the data. So we moving or just set up there. So now there are two setups. One setup, the government of India collected the data, water quality data using Ganga River data during the Kumbh Mela. And the other one in a pond in the institute, we collected the data using our own developed sensor node or IoT node. Now, what are the data sample statistics that we have collected actually? So the Ganga River data set, that data set what we got is, we collected these things, DO, pH, temperature, ammonia, TSS, turbidity, nitrate, water level, TOC, COD. Water level is not important for us because in this experiment, we are not considering the water level. Now, what is the mean of all the 16,000, whatever number of data, how many data sets? 16,100. So in my data set, these are the statistics. The mean of the DO value is 6.05. The standard deviation is 2.8. Minimum is 0.1. Maximum is 9.78. So similarly, we have all the parameters. So this is my my data set with 16,100 samples, and the statistical properties of those samples are given in this table. Just to tell you that, why they say that, just to mention that there is a wide range of change in the data set over a period of data collection time. So we don't collect for a minute or 2 minutes or 3 minutes. So we collected over months of time, so that there is a standard deviation, there is a variance in the data, and in that variance, in the presence of the variability also, we should be able to predict properly. Now, what we did, we thought that there are some 8 to 10 parameters, and all 8 to 10 parameters, if you use for mod, say, for example, what is this actually? Now we have X1, X2, X3, up to let's say X10, and this is the function of this, and we have to predict Y. What is Y? Y is my COD. So X1, X2, X3, X4, etc. we take up to X10, and Y is my COD. If I can predict Y is my COD properly, that's it. Now we thought that this 10, 11, 20, 12 parameters makes the model very complex. So first what we did a covariance, a PCA kind of a thing. We did PCA, eigenvalue, etc. to find out what are the parameters which are actually important. So we found out that, and if you look at this, the parameters which are important is that, look at this actually. So this is one, DO is 0.72, that eigenvalue is 0.72. Then pH is 0.27. Temperature is 0.08, right? So I ignored temperature, dropped. Temperature dropped. Ammonia is 0.96, so ammonia is contributing much. TSS, total solid, so that is 0.92. So this will be there, this will be there, DO will be there, pH will be there, and what else? Nitrate will be there, and all others are very, they're very insignificant. So how many parameters there? 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, and look at this COD. Now COD, you don't need COD now, because we need to predict COD. So initially when you have COD values we measured in the laboratory and put that also. So look at the COD value measurement, 22.96 is the mean. Standard deviation is 38. Mean is, minimum is 0.9, maximum is 196. So that's the variation, that's the variability, that's the variance. So we have all sorts of COD measurement values in the sample, and we have to develop the model so that the COD value prediction or estimation will be as good as the measured, in the laboratory experiment actually. So what are the parameters you have taken? pH, so these are the things. DO means dissolved oxygen, how much oxygen is present in the water, pH value, then ammonia, TSS, and nitrate. So these are the five sensor values we have taken. Other sensor values we have ignored actually. We didn't consider all the 10 parameters, we have considered only up to X5. And these are the five X1s actually. Now, what we did, we tried many machine learning models in fact, and then you see, if you look at this, let me zoom it a bit. Yeah. See, there is a record, there is a record here. Let's say, look at this point. Look at the highest point. Highest point is near 200. So this is what is the actual COD which we measured in the laboratory. Now look at the right side, below that estimated COD. Estimated COD is also the same thing. My point here is that this is experiment one. What is experiment one? Experiment one is the data set of the Ganga River. So from the Ganga River data set, we use a single fold machine learning algorithm. And we found that the estimated value and the actual value, they are almost same. They're almost same. There is a variance. So I'll put up the, So I'll put up the statistics here. Now look at the next part of it. So the in this case, we find that the Ganga River data COD value, what they have measured in the laboratory and displayed on the in their portal, we collected all the data except COD. We didn't collect COD. We collected COD for testing purpose. So we used the other data items and predicted COD values. And we chose the data items over a period of time so that the COD, there is a large variance in the COD data. It's not constant, but still we are able to predict, estimate the value of the COD using software model or soft sensor instead of the physical sensor. Or here, the physical sensor for COD is the chemistry laboratory experiment or environmental science laboratory experiment. Then what we did, so this we thought, we don't have any control. We don't know what is the data there. How do we do? We collected the data using this one, right? If you remember this, just a minute. So this is my experimental setup one that is on the right side. On the left side, we have experimental setup two, which we developed the model. In the nearby pond, we collected the data that the sewage treatment plant. And then that also, look at this. We collected, because we understood that this sewage,
participants, I think it seems Udgata sir is offline. I think he will join. So please be online.
There is a connection problem here now.
Sir will join shortly. Please be online.
Hello, sir. Can you hear me, sir? Sir, please unmute, sir. Please unmute from your side.
Thank you. So I don't know. I got disconnected. When I got disconnected also, I don't know.
Yeah, just 2-3 minutes back, sir.
2-3 minutes back. So let me share this screen again.
Yes, sir. Yeah, this completed, sir, this slide.
This slide is completed. Very good.
Yeah, you are discussing this one only, sir.
Yeah. This also?
Your slides are not moving, sir.
Now it will move probably. Check.
Yes, sir.
Moving?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. You are currently in this slide. Yeah. Completed, sir. Completed.
Completed. This slide also completed, right?
Yes. It's long back completed.
Okay. Then I'm not very far. Okay. So what I was trying to say that sorry for the trouble, but it's beyond our control. But anyway. So what I was trying to say that we conducted that experiment using the Ganga River data. And I think in the chat box, somebody is writing that from which site you collected data. I think I'll share a paper. It is there in IEEE. It is published in the IEEE Sensors Journal. If you look at that paper, we have given that. I don't remember exactly what is the site address, but you can either Google it or see that paper. We have given the reference there. Yeah. So we set up our own IoT experiment, and then we collected the data because we now know that what are the important parameters using the PC analysis, etc. So we use only those sensors for collecting the data, and we use ammonia, TSS, DO, and pH. And then what we did, we tried to predict what will be the value of COD in the using the machine learning models. So in this case, I mean we use all models, actually, random forest, decision tree, SBM, and so many things, MLR, etc. But we found that KNN with K value equal to 1 used to give the best result. That also I will tell you. Now see, this is a slightly better view. I'm just zooming it out. If you look at this, the blue lines are the actual values and the predicted ones are the red lines. And mostly, if you look at this, the total idea, if you look at this, they are almost same. There is a slight variation in the predicted and the actual value, and that variation is almost negligible. So what do you do here? So this is what basically I'm trying to tell you, that this is the paper actually I was trying to talk about. So the development of chemical oxygen on demand, that is the COD soft sensor using edge intelligence. So in the edge intelligence means, I mean, if you look at this, I mean, this is the paper, and it was it's already published in the IEEE Sensors Journal. So if you want any more information on this particular talk, you better refer this paper, and there are other references also. And somebody asked about the data set, etc. It is already available in this paper only. You can download from that site if it is available. Otherwise, if you write to us, we have the data set, I can send it back to you. Right. Now, basically, what is that I tried to say? I tried to say that, yes, yeah. So I tried to present that COD is a physical sensor, which is the measurement of the physical sensor COD is difficult. It is also costly. So we tried to develop a soft sensor for COD so that it can replace the physical sensor. We tried, we did PCA, we did other machine learning techniques, etc. So in this talk, I introduced this. You can read the paper. If you want data set, you can download from this site. If that is not working, because that was a 2 years back data set, I don't know whether the Government of India is still maintaining that site or not. And another thing is that was a online, it's a continuous thing, right? So they were not having a database kind of a thing. So we just downloaded from, every time there is a refresh, we downloaded it actually. So that is what. Now, as I told you, we also worked with the BOD, but the challenges are different actually. You can say that the same way the time BOD works, the same way the COD works. No, the challenges are different. The important parameters are different, that ammonia. And so if you look at this previous one, we have, what are the parameters? Ammonia, TSS, DO, pH, etc. These are the sensors. Now here, in this case, the sensors are different, right? So when the sensors are different, we have DO sensor, we have a temperature sensor, we have pH sensor, we have conductivity, we have oxidation reduction potential that comes in voltage. So there is a turbidity. Now see the challenge here is that the sensors are not uniform here. There are different type of sensors. Some gives voltages, some gives current. So your conductivity gives current actually. The sensor which you have used gives you ampere, milliampere. ORP gives millivolts. Temperature, there are a lot of problems. So again, what we did, because BOD requires, I don't want to talk about the chemistry of BOD. BOD requires culture actually. You have to take the water sample to the laboratory, test it, and then find out how the DO value means the dissolved oxygen value, keeps changing over a period of time for 5 years, sorry, for 5 days. And after 5 days, that gradient of change, etc., will help you to measure the BOD. So to BOD measurements requires 5 days in the laboratory culture environment. Now, if you want online BOD thing, it's not available yet. So in this case, what we did, we took 400 samples for the collection. That 16,100, that river Ganga sample is still there with us. There also the BOD there. So use the river Ganga sample plus the sample which we collected. We collected around 400 samples. Now you can tell us why you are taking only 400, why not 4,000 or 10,000 or 40,000, etc. Remember, the actual BOD values are calculated or found out in the laboratory environment. So you have to take the sample, go to the environmental science laboratory. In the laboratory, they will find out the BOD. That takes a lot of time actually. So 400, we thought is good enough. That also took us around 3-4 months actually. So in this case also, I mean, in that example, I didn't show you about the different methods. This also we did there. So in this case, we use linear regression, multilayer perceptron, MLP, SBM, IBK, K-star algorithm, random forest algorithm, random tree algorithm, rep tree algorithm. There are so many algorithms. In fact, there are many other algorithms also we have tried. And what you are trying to say that, what are the results what you are getting? That means, what is the correlation coefficient you are getting? What is the mean absolute value you are getting? Mean absolute error you are getting. What is the RMS, root mean square error you are getting? What is the relative error you are getting? What is the root related square error you are getting? Now, if you look at this, the correlation coefficient means the correlation between the actual value and the estimated value. Now look at this, linear regression is not giving good result. 0.6 is not a good result. Multilayer perceptron is good, but it is still not very good. SBM is still good, 0.9996. That means 99.9% accuracy almost. This IBK is still better, right? But if you look at mean absolute error, IBK is still better than anything else. Root mean square error, IBK is, root mean square error is just 0.0117. This is pretty good actually. Relative absolute error is only 0.15%. I repeat, 0.15%. And the root related means from the root point, it is 2.228%. So if you look at all other things, IBK. So IBK seems to be the best algorithm that is used for, or that is used, or that can be used for the, what do you call, the BOD estimation. Just a minute, somebody is sending continuously messages. Just 1 minute. Okay, good. Sorry. So this IBK algorithm used to give for this BOD prediction, IBK algorithm seems to be very good. IBK, you know, instant based algorithm, right? So instance based K, nearest K algorithm. So IBK algorithm is giving the best result. In case of COD, KNN, K nearest neighbor application. So KNN was giving the good result actually. So just for a small, you have seen this, but as a textual format, let's say, the actual value is 1.218. That was the BOD value. We could predict, the system could predict 1.218. The error was zero. The actual value was 1.108. We could get 1.107. That's a 0.001 difference. So if you look at this, there are very few cases where the, say for example, in this case, the error is in 0.196. That's also not big, but still the error is big here. But in all other cases, the error is within the tolerable limit. So again, the same thing, this we did for the, our own IoT setup, and this we did for the Ganga data. As you know, that the river Ganga data, when we collected it, it has BOD, it has DO, it has pH, it has temperature, it is ammonia, COD, TSS, nitrate, water level, everything is there actually. So in this case, again, the same thing. We got the same data, we got it for IBK only. This IBK only the best, so far is the best result. Now, why I'm saying this, because, and why you are doing this, if you remember, the soft sensor requires that key, we have to have a model which will give me the actual value and the estimated value, and the estimated value and actual value, you have to find out what is the difference there actually. Now, in this case, we use various models actually, IBK model, etc. So what I did, we collected the data and we have to validate it. So how do I validate it? Suppose I say that, okay, look, this paper will not be accepted if I collect my IoT data and say that, okay, look, this is the only one experiment. They say, okay, we don't know about your experiment, etc. So we collected two different data sets with two different statistical properties and proved that, okay, in both the cases, the results are almost acceptable, right? They are almost consistent, whether it is in the Ganga data or it is in the STP, the sewage treatment plant data. And there are two different data sets actually, and two different purposes. In the Ganga, people use it for drinking and bathing. STP, it is used for gardening and all that. So there are two different applications, two different type of water quality, but still we are able to do it. So this is again the same thing. We are almost getting the same in the Ganga data set also. We are getting almost the similar actual and predicted value. The errors are also very limited. And remember, this slide is not under my control. Not under my control. This is what I'm downloading from the Ganga data. The other one was under our control. We collected the data. So this is the result actually. This is we used ANN also. So just I'm giving you a small, I mean, ultimately that ANN didn't work. We have to go for IBK. But I'm just giving you a small key. We took some 2000 samples and the DO value is calculated. And somewhere you see that key, there is a blue line. The blues are visible actually. So when you took the first experiment with the 2020 neurons, 2020 model MLP structure, the result was not good. But when I took 25 MLP structure, the results are good. You can see that key, the blues are not visible on the downline. That means the blues are embedded. That means the blue, the actual and the measured value are almost same. In the previous one or in the top one, the actual and the measured one are not the same. But ultimately, we got better result in IBK compared to ANN also. So this is a paper, I mean, recently came out. This is in Springer, published in the Springer Complex and Intelligent Systems Journal, Machine Learning Based Soft Sensor Model for BOD Estimation Using Intelligence at Edge. So yeah. And I have another 5 minutes time. Yeah, I have some time. Now, this is only one slide which I wish to discuss. And this result is not yet published, actually. In fact, we communicated somewhere. Now, what we thought, Ki, what do you do with all these things, right? You collect data and you do all these things. And finally, what do? It has to give you some information. What is the action? The action is here. So Aquasense is the project name, actually. The project name was the Aquasense and machine learning model for intelligent alert generation. So what we did, I mean, look at the diagram and I'll just zoom it a bit. Yeah. So if you look at this, there are different colored lines here. Look at this left side. There are different colored lines here. Turbidity, pH, conductivity, chlorine, total carbon, etc. So we collect this data over a period of time. Now this data, when it comes, right, if you plot it, they look like this. Some are at the top, some are at the bottom, etc. Now these data come and look at this. Now this data, we put a software. What is that software actually we are doing? We take the data, let's say I have taken 5 parameters and to each parameter I have given a weight. That's also intelligently decided. And then I convert it to one value. So for example, we have X1, X2, X3. Let's say I have X1, X2, X3. X4, etc. Right? These are the 4 parameters. I take a function of that. And this function will give me a y value. So this y value is this, the first one. So I convert it to one value. So this one value, I plot it. I plot this one value. Look at this one value. Now this one value I plotted. So these 5 values, these 5 curves are now converted to only one curve. Now, if you see then I decide a threshold value. If it is beyond a particular value, then this is an alarming. That means there is something wrong in that particular data set. So when I say something wrong in that particular data set, it's an alarming situation. But we thought that, okay, what is that alarming situation? Why it is alarming? Is there a reason? Now, what we did during that alarming point, at that particular point, we thought that, okay, what are the values of the pH? What is the change in the values of the pH, conductivity, turbidity, chlorine, total carbon, etc.? That means these X1, X2, X3 values are. What is the exact value? And what is the change with respect to the previous value or previous 5 values or previous 10 values? So we took this fingerprint and collected it. Now, once you collect this fingerprint, so what we did, we took some 2000 records, around 2000 records we have taken. Out of the 2000 records, we found that there are around, we injected contamination, and the injected contamination, we found alarms there. And these alarms, we took some alarms, actually, let's say 200 alarms, and then we classified them. So the classified them means we use fuzzy SIMINS algorithm, K-means clustering algorithm, we grouped them actually. So we found that there are four groups we came with four groups we came actually. What are the four groups? So the four groups actually basically points that key, what is this particular alarm? Is it intentional contamination? That means somebody has come and added something. If somebody will come and add something, a chemical, then immediately one particular parameter will suit. All others will not suit. Is it a accidental contamination? That means some pipe burst has happened or something has happened and the outside water or something has merged into the pipe. And that's an, so we tried to classify whether it's an intentional contamination, accidental contamination, or a natural contamination. Slowly it changed actually. So the slowly changes also will be classified as a separate one. Slow changes means over a period of time. There is a pharmaceutical industry and they started sending their data, sending their water to some field, and the field is slowly getting contaminated. So that's a slow contamination. At some point of time, it becomes alarming. So whether it is an accidental contamination, whether it is an intentional contamination, whether it is a natural contamination, or we cannot determine. So we found out four such things. Now, why I'm doing this? I'm doing this because when I test, suppose tomorrow I get an alarm that your water quality is bad, then this alarm will also come with a classification, whether it is a group one or group two or group three or group four. That means I will be able to know whether it is an accidental contamination or intentional contamination or natural contamination, or we are not able to find out any one of the three above. So that's a model for alert generation, what type of alert it is, right? So this is the overall architecture of the total model. Like we put sensors. So these are the sensors, they are deployed with water quality sensors, etc. So we have a data filter, we don't want to send them. Then the data aggregation, data fusion, etc. This is the idea actually. So here we put all the intelligent distance support system here. Now this, the entire algorithm here, whatever we have discussed, is in this module, in the server. Now then the alarm event comes, you decide, the machine learning algorithm will decide what type of alarm it is and all that. So whatever we have discussed, right? We developed a module, and there is a site WSN system for water quality, EquaSense. Initially, we deployed at two different places because that was a part of the project. So this is a Google map where we deployed it. And we tried to find out, if you go there, it will try to find out what is the pH value there, what is the conductivity value there, etc. And we have a continuous monitoring system. Now, remember, I tell you, this DO value and somewhere this DO value, COD value, etc., they are not actual sensors deployed there. I repeat, they are not actual sensors or physical sensors deployed there. They are the soft sensor there. But temperature sensor were there, pH sensor were there, conductivity sensor were there, ORP sensor were there. So we created a node with these things. DO value we estimated using the model which we have developed, and then we created a website when you go there and see that. So the user has, or the people do not have an idea that whether the DO is a physical sensor or a virtual sensor or a soft sensor. So similarly, we estimated VNR VJIT is an institute here, they collaborated with us here, and then there is a Pragati Nagar lake also we tried to deploy there, and we got some data just like that. And I mean, these are the continuous monitoring system, node one, node two, node three, etc. So there is a bore water well where we deployed this also. Yeah, some of the students at that time, this is not an ongoing work now. This is 1 year back, 2 years back work actually. So some of the students who went and deployed these sensor nodes, and then we got it, etc. So this was, I think I must thank the DST and all these people. They supported this DST and DET, at that time DET, Department of Electronics and Information Technology. Now it is Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. So first we got a small project between 2008 to 11, and then for 5 years we got a project between 2013 to 2018. So this is the thanks, and thank you, and I'm done. Hello.
Yes, sir. Thanks, sir. Yeah. Thanks yeah. A lot, sir. Thanks a lot for sharing your research output, sir. Yeah, I think there are some couple of questions are there in the chat, sir. Shall I read out, sir?
I'll just check if I can read it out. Chat. Yeah. Yes. So one question is that key, how to decide
which attribute is more responsible to calculate COD?
Yeah. How to decide which attribute is more responsible to calculate COD? I think I mentioned about it. Maybe I'm slightly disconnected then or not. So the whole idea was that key, for example, in the Ganga River data set, right, they have some 12, 14 parameters. So we downloaded all the 12, 14 parameters. And then we found COD, and then we found out that covariance matrix, right? Covariance matrix, PC, and all these things we did, found out eigenvalues, etc. So the principal component analysis will tell you. It's better advice that you do go for a principal component analysis followed by eigenvalue. So the principal component analysis will tell you which parameters or which attributes are important or contributing much towards the dependent variable. So we found that key, these are the, I think that's where I spoke also. The pH value is contributing, let's say, some 28%. The ammonia is contributing, let's say, 48%. Not 48%, the weight is for 0.48. So we decided a threshold value. Anything less than 0.3, we will not consider. So we ignored those parameters, those variables, those sensors, which do not contribute highly to the calculation of the COD, or do not significantly contribute to the calculation of the COD. Why I did that? Because when you deploy this, actually, we will require very few sensors. So that is one. I think somebody has written you are not audible, but I don't know.
No, it was earlier, sir, actually. At that time, okay. It was disconnected.
Okay. Road or location map, which software is used, sir? What is road or location map?
You have shown the placement of the sensor, no, sir, using the GPS values, the Google Map one.
That is one in Pragati Nagar Lake. I think people who are from Hyderabad, they will know. And one in that institute, and another in my where I'm staying in a society. So it's not a road actually.
The participant is asking the software. It is basically the Google Maps. You can tell, sir. Maybe
it's a Google Map. It's a Google Map. There's nothing else.
Google Maps. Yeah, the participant is asking about the software.
So
that's a Google Map only.
Participants can raise their hand outside if you have any questions, so that I can unmute you.
Yeah, there is one question, I think, Ms. Hemalata. Am I audible?
Yes, sir. Please proceed, sir.
There is one question, Ms. Hemalata is saying that for implementing soft sensor, anyhow, we need to take data from the hard sensor, right, sir? Yes, it is right. But we are taking the physical data from the physical sensors to predict the soft sensor or to develop the model for soft sensor for another sensor, not for the same sensor. Even if you do that, in fact, we are writing another paper. Say, for example, even if you have a hardware sensor or a physical sensor, right? And anyhow, we have to accept that the physical sensors also can go wrong, also can become erratic, etc. So there can be another soft sensor, which is an additional sensor. Even in the presence of a hard sensor, you can have another soft sensor there so that you can keep on validating each other. They keep on validating each other also. That's for a mission critical application. You can have a hard sensor and you can have a soft sensor also. But for most of the applications so far, in that case, a soft sensor will replace a physical sensor using some other physical sensors, not this physical sensor. I think I'm clear here. And what else?
Yes, sir. To correlate the values, actually. That's what I think
I think he said
location. There's one more question is there, sir.
Yeah, tell me, what is that?
Is there any sensor to detect alcohol smell? I think
there are many.
A participant is looking for MQ3, I think.
There are many, actually.
MQ3 and others, they can use it actually for experimentation.
Many, actually, just type alcohol sensor, go to Amazon also, will get it. Don't worry. Yeah. So thank you, Naganarji.
Yeah. Thank you, sir. Thank you very much, sir.
Thank you.
Thanks a lot, sir.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So yeah. Just a small announcements for the participants.
Okay. I can log out, sir.
This is the end of our Sorry, sir.
I can log out. I can leave the
meeting. Yes, sir. Please, sir. Yeah. Yes, yes, yes. Thank you, sir.
So you continue, Naganderji. Thank you very much for the opportunity, and thanks everybody.
Yeah. Yes, sir. Thank you, sir. Thanks a lot, sir. Yeah. Participants are very happy. Actually, it is. It's a nice session and very informative session, sir. Thank you very much.
Then it's not but direct, but I think the other sessions are directly hardware and other things. So I thought we will also talk about soft sensors and all that. There is a lot of scope for.
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah. Thank you. How do I stop sharing? Yeah, stop sharing. Yeah.
Hemalata, I am there. I'm online. I'll go. I'll come to the fridging part now. Don't worry. Just hold on for 5 minutes.
Okay.
Srinivas, sir.
Yes, sir.
Please complete the poll process now.
Yes, sir.
So participants are requested to complete the polling of this session. And one more announcement. I think the attendance part is already been given to you, the attendance report for the 5 days. If you have any clarifications, please let us know before the exam starts. The exam will be being at 2:30 p.m. sharply. Yeah. And those who want to know about the freezing process, just kindly hold on for 5-10 minutes, please. I will take this one small example with the freezing. Now, there are one participant has requested. So it may be useful for others. Those who want it, kindly hold on in this session only. Yes, for within 2 minutes, I will start that. Please complete the polling process. We can start the freezing now. Yeah. Please complete the polling process, please. All the participants are requested to complete the polling process. For the fifth day, a tick mark is used either to present or absent. Please look to the column of present or absent. Tick mark is used only there. Yeah. If there is any corrections, please let us know. Otherwise, if the attendance is okay, please you can continue with your examination. There's no problem.
Participants are requested to give their feedback. So far, 79% votes are casted, given. So 79%.
Yeah, any FDP programs from EC department? Yes, of course. In near future, you will see some more. Srinivas, sir, can you see my screen?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I think polling is completed. You can stop the polling now.
Yes, sir. I will stop it, sir.
Okay. Good afternoon to all participants. Those who are just to like to know how the freezing process can be done properly. So I'll take a small example here. Of course, the exercises are given to you in the day one. Maybe some of you are not clear with that. So I'll take up a small example and let me just complete this. So is my screen clear, visible, Srinivasa?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. So I'm just starting the freezing application. I hope everybody has received that one and you know how to open it, right? So once you open the freezing process, please go to the file, go to the new. So you are opening a new freezing board. So if you are going to play with breadboards, yes, automatically a breadboard will come. If you don't want to have a breadboard, you can delete it. So what I'm trying to do is I am now taking the components, the core parts, which are available on the freezing. So let me take a small example here, of course, just to show the process of freezing onto your Raspberry Pi simulator. So here we have a Raspberry Pi. I have taken the Raspberry Pi from the core part. And also I'm taking an LED. Okay. So now let me just maximize the screen. So I have taken these two components. One is the Raspberry Pi, the mini computer, and one small LED. Now I have to connect this. Of course, you can take the help of breadboard also, but here Raspberry Pi do have that connection to be performed directly here. So you can take, please look to the pins of your Raspberry Pi, the GPIO pins, please. So I have the ground pin here. So I am taking the LED and connecting to the ground pin. So this is basically the same diagram which you are seeing on our the notes which I have given to you. Yes, you can see this is the notes which are given to you. So you can see the same diagram. Once again, I'm showing this how to run this program. So a LED which is connected to your Raspberry Pi, the same diagram. I am just showing you here the small thing. So this particular pin, you are connecting to one of the pin of your GPIO. So this is your GPIO, which is your anode. The anode is connected to this and the cathode is connected to the ground pin of your Raspberry Pi. So ground, the Raspberry Pi ground pin is connected to your cathode and your anode is connected to your GPIO. See, you can see the GPIO4. The pin number is GPIO4 here. So once you connect your components like this, please save your file. First, you need to save your file. So you can save your file at some location. I'm saving it in this documents, something like example. You can save it in a particular folder. So once you save your file, now you need to export. So you go to the export and as an image with the extension SVG. So export this example 10_bb.svg. This is an image file, just an image file. This is SVG, a graphics, support vector graphics format this is. So just you save this one. Example 10. Yes, once you exported that, and as well as you have to export the XML, the code or the functionalities of that one. So I'm exporting the XML extensions also. So example 10. Yes. So two things are exported. Once the image and the other thing is your XML code. So once you have done this one, now go to your Raspberry Pi simulator. So I'm using the same web.wildwritten.studio. You can either install on your system or you can directly connect through the web. So I'm connecting to the web here. So once you get that green color mark, it's sufficient for you. So create a new application. A new application. So here you are going to Raspberry Pi, you are using the JavaScript code. So here example 10, give a name to your program, create the project. Yes, once the project is created, open the application. And click the connect button. Once you click the connect button, you get the Raspberry Pi simulator here. So select the Raspberry Pi simulator. Once you select the Raspberry Pi simulator, please select the Raspberry Pi simulator and go to the left side of your screen, go to the menu and select load schema, the schema which you have designed. Schema is basically the structure, the circuit, the branch which you have designed. Please select the load schema. And now it will ask for the add SVG file and the add XML netlist. So select add SVG file. So the SVG file is example 10 underscore BB SVG. Yes, you have taken that, selected. So your example 10 underscore BB.SVG is added to this. Then go to the XML file. The XML is example 10. It is selected and it has been imported onto your load schema. Then you click the upload button. So once you click the upload button, your schema, this is your design schema, is been uploaded onto this. So now go to application, go to the application and you need to write the code here so that to blink that particular LED. So you can take our example, what is the examples we have given to you. In the examples, the tutorial we have shared to you, this is the tutorial file only. So this is the code for your blinking that particular LED. So the same code I'm taking here, which is connected to the GPIO4. And you have written a function called blink LED, and you are making the LED to glow for certain duration and off for certain duration here. So 2000 milliseconds, it will be wait. So copy that code. And paste here. Srinivasa, is my screen visible?
Yes, sir.
So I hope the participants are there, those who are just having the doubts. I hope you are able to see this one, right?
Yes, sir. We could see the screen, sir.
Yes, yeah, screen. Okay.
Yes, sir.
Of course, you can write your programming logic. Your logic, it depends. If you run, here is only on and off. So you can, based on your logic, you can change this one. So now what I do, once you paste your code, then you can go for your run. So run option is there here on the screen. So you just click the run and you go to the schematic. There's a problem with thing. Just let me know. Hold on. It's always on here. I think there is, I missed some point here or here. Ashish is there?
No,
Ashish has not come. Sidoni, I'm online. Just follow. This LED program, the source code, have you tested it?
LED program? Yes. That was only done.
No. This is Raspberry Pi.
No. I don't.
Ask assistant. Can I take Arduino board in freezing and do the same steps further in well-written? Arduino boards are not supported in the well-written, ma'am. The boards which are supported in well-written, please check the, there are Raspberry Pi, BeagleBone and other boards. So anyway, I'll just check the code, and if I miss any step, I'll get back to you. You can have your lunch and can get back to the 2:30. So at 2:30, I'll try to demonstrate it again. So I request the participants to have your lunch and come back at 2:30. So once the demonstration is completed, then you can complete it. Yeah. Srinivas, sir. Yeah, test is at 2:30. We'll start at 2:30.
Yes, sir. I'm online.
Yeah, please. Now you can just stop the session now and yes, ask them. Yeah. So we I request all the participants to have your lunch and come back at 2:30. By the time I will debug this program and get back to you. What is the mistake? I'll try to find out. Yeah.
May I stop the session, sir?
No. Not DHT. No, you are not.
May I close the session, sir?
Yes, please.